Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Our reading for this morning's sermon is from that, quite frankly, odd reading in Luke chapter 8. Exorcisms are a strange topic for us today. The thought of demon possession makes us squirm around in our chairs. But who are we to say that it actually doesn't happen? The Bible is chock full of demon possessions and exorcisms. Jesus dealt with a demon-possessed man who interrupted his preaching in the Capernaum synagogue. After the transfiguration, Jesus comes down from the mountain and heals a young boy who is possessed by an evil spirit. In Acts, people continuously brought the sick and those afflicted with unclean spirits to be healed by the apostles. And in today's reading, Jesus, the exorcist, encounters yet another demon-possessed man. And Jesus just finished calming a storm for his scared disciples. So today, everyone is a little on edge. Jesus has to question his disciples' faith in the midst of the storm, and rightly so, since the disciples ask amongst themselves about Jesus, "Who is this, that he commands even the winds and water, and they obey him?" Yes, Christ commands creation. He speaks, and it obeys. And if that amazed the disciples, then they are in for a real treat. For as soon as Jesus steps out of the boat onto dry land, there met him a man from the city who had demons. Many demons. A legion of demons. That is what they call themselves when Jesus asks. Legion. It's a military word. A Roman legion numbered anywhere from 4,000 to 6,000 soldiers. So the demons are out for battle. And they have ravished this man. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he had not lived in a house, but among the tombs. It's quite fitting that the demon drives a man to live among the dead. That is where they belong. For there is no true life in them. Satan belongs to the realm of death. His demons go with him, and they drag this man down with them. He's been naked for a long time. He often wails loudly in the night, and he was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, probably because he ran around naked and cut himself with sharp stones. But a metal straitjacket seemed to be no match for a legion of demons. And so they drove him out to live among the dead. But here comes Jesus. He steps out of the boat onto the devil's turf. Satan likes to think he owns things. He even tempts Jesus with the kingdoms of the world as if they are his to give in the first place. Even Jesus calls him the prince of this world. But at the same time, Jesus says that the prince of this world is judged, and he will be cast out. For the Lord of all creation has come into the world to defeat Satan and his demons. The devil wants to put up a fight. Now, I have always wondered if the storm that Jesus and his disciples endured on their way to this land was not stirred up by the devil himself in an attempt to keep Jesus away. Maybe, maybe not, but nevertheless, it is true that as much as the devil wants to put up a good fight, he knows that he can't win, and the demons seem to know that as well, for they demand of Jesus as soon as they see him, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." That's quite a confession from a legion of demons. They certainly know who Jesus is, and it's not the first time that the demons have known who Jesus is. They are well aware that he is from God, that he is God. They know his name well, even if they refuse to worship him. But at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess, even the demons. And then they beg Jesus not to command them to depart into the abyss. That's an odd request from the demons. Jesus had already commanded them to come out of this man. And you see, the demons know that whatever Jesus commands, they must do. He has all authority over them, just as he has all authority over the wind and the waves. They have no power to resist him. They must leave the man, but they beg Jesus not to cast them into the abyss. For the demons know that a time is coming when they will be defeated, utterly defeated, once and for all. They know that eventually they won't have any power to roam free over the earth. They won't have any power to possess men. And so just as they tormented this man as they possessed him for many years, a time is coming when they will be thrown into the abyss, be numbered among the dead, bound with chains and left to wail about with no one coming to their aid. And so they beg Jesus to hold off on this final judgment and not to cast them into the abyss. And now a large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. And they begged Jesus to let them enter these, so he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. Jesus allows the demons to choose their own path of destruction. He grants them permission. Ironically, however, the possessed pigs run over a cliff, fall into a lake, and drown, taking the legion of demons with them. It seems that they run into the abyss after all. This event foreshadows the final defeat of Satan described in Revelation 20. And the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now this scene of the herd and the pig, the herd of pigs running over a cliff, falling into a lake and drowning, obviously caused quite a commotion. The herdsmen there ran to tell what they just witnessed to everybody else. The people were shocked, dumbfounded even, and quite afraid. The power and authority of Jesus scared them. And so they asked Jesus to leave, to get back into his boat and go somewhere else. The once possessed man, now in his right mind, is sitting, humbly sitting, clothed at the feet of his Lord Christ. The unclean has been made clean. He wants to be a disciple. He wants to follow in the footsteps of this rabbi. He wants to learn from Jesus. But our Lord gives him different marching orders. Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you. And the man went away, proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done for him. What a powerful proclamation of Christ's mercy and healing that must have been for people to hear. A demon-possessed man who used to live naked among the tombs, among the dead, goes all around the 10 cities of the Gentiles, proclaiming the good news of Christ. This story certainly sounds strange to our ears. It has many important details that, for us, sometimes can be tough to believe. Brothers and sisters in Christ, don't be deceived. The demonic realm is quite real. Satan prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour, and legions of demons do his bidding. The deceiver might operate differently in different times and cultures with different people. But just because he doesn't always show himself to us like he did with this demon-possessed man does not mean that Satan isn't at work among us. Sometimes it's obvious, oftentimes it's not. But we have Christ on our side, and quite frankly, that's all that matters. That's all that mattered in Luke chapter 8. For he has full authority and power even over Satan and the demons. And so this story actually happened, and so much more. For while we walk among the dead, while we were still dead in our trespasses, Christ died on the cross, went to death to save you. He went to the tomb for you, the living one, among the dead, for the dead. He wasn't cut with sharp stones, but he was pierced with a spear for your transgressions as he hung there naked, dead on a tree. He was humiliated so that you might be righteous. And what Jesus did for the demon-possessed man here in Luke 8, he has done for you in your baptism. The Word of God teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful under the power of Satan until Christ claims us as his own. And so Christ, the Exorcist, casts out your demons through water and his word. He has broken the chains and shackles of Satan and snatched you out of his clutches. Christ speaks his word and Satan must bend the knee. Christ speaks his word and you belong to him. Christ washes you with water and you are cleansed of all your sin and shame. Christ buries your naked, dead self with himself in your baptism. And you rise out of the font a new man clothed in the white robes of Christ's righteousness. And so Satan no longer rules over you. You have a new king, a new Lord, Christ the crucified. And what Jesus did to that legion of demons in Luke 8 is a picture of what he will do, what he promises to do when he returns on the last day. He will cast out Satan into the abyss, that eternal fire that has been prepared for the devil and his angels. But you who are righteous, you who are washed in the blood of his death, you who are washed with water and his word, you will be given into eternal life. And while we wait for that blessed day, brothers and sisters in Christ, we sit right here at the feet of our Lord. We learn the scriptures. We hear his word of forgiveness. We are fed a meal by which we proclaim his death until he comes in glory. And he tells us to return to our homes, to depart in peace as he goes with us. For this good news is not only for us. It is for your family. It's for your neighbors, your friends, your coworkers. For Jesus has won the victory for us. He has accomplished our salvation for us. How could we not proclaim his glorious works? In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We stand for the offertory.